It's about tech giants supporting female entrepreneurship. So getting an overview, what is out there? And how is it actually to participate? Camilla from QIT will take you through it and let you much more know. Please join us on stage.
Hi everyone, so thank you for joining our panel. I would like to just briefly introduce these lovely ladies that I have with me today. First of all, we have Nana Bule. She is the COO and CMO of Microsoft. Then we have Charlotte Aspeheim Smith. She is the EMEA Program Manager in Dell for Entrepreneurs. And finally, we have Alina Engel. She is the COO and co-founder of the startup Hooves. You can hear more about Hooves at 2 on this stage today, where her co-founder is going to pitch the service. But we'll get back to that. So today, the topic for this panel is actually the programs that the very large technology companies are offering for female entrepreneurs. As you may or may not have noticed, most of the tech giants have some sort of initiative to support women in tech or female entrepreneurs specifically, maybe girls in tech, things like this. It's all really nice and meaningful, and sometimes it can be a bit difficult to understand exactly what are these programs about and how do I apply, is it worth it for me? So this is kind of what we're going to talk about today. So it's going to be rather practical and also a little bit reflective on the topic. But before we do that, I think we should get to know these panelists a little bit better. So I'll give each of you a chance to present yourselves and your companies, and then after that we'll move into the more details about the programs. So Nana, would you like to start?
So my name is Nana. I work for Microsoft in Denmark, where I run operations and go-to-market for the Danish business and the Danish market. I've been in tech for 18 years, a bit more actually, and felt quite alone. So I'm so happy to see so many females here. No, it is an industry that definitely needs more females to go into. I think some of the large problems we have to solve in the world, we need the full scale of diversity to actually be able to solve those.
Alina.
Yeah, hi, I'm Alina from Hooves. And we're the first ones to bring horses into the sharing economy. It's a very elitist sport, meaning it's very expensive and very time consuming. So we facilitate the sharing of horses and thereby getting more people into the sport. And I'm just came out of university actually. We started Hooves while we were still studying, my co-founder Subi and I. And it's been a really interesting journey and we've been able to make it a little company by now. And really excited to hear more about these initiatives.
Thank you. Charlotte, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yes, my name is Charlotte Aspeheim, and I've also been in IT for 17 years at Dell, actually. Dell changes all the time. We have new solutions. I've just found it just as exciting as you have. I mainly work with, I'm a messaging manager in Europe, Middle East and Africa, to ensure that we articulate our message the way we should and so that people understand what we are talking about. And I'm also program managing Dell for entrepreneurs in EMEA.
Thank you, that was very nice. If you can talk a little bit about the program that Dell is offering for females specifically and kind of enlighten us on the high levels of that, that would
be
awesome.
So at Dell we have a program called DWEN, Dell Women Entrepreneurial Network. And this is a network where we encourage, we tie all these female entrepreneurs together globally into a network where they can share best practices, collaborate. We also give them access to not only the network, but capital and, of course, technology. We mentor them in different ways, and these can be all kinds of companies. It doesn't have to be tech, but all companies together today needs tech, right? And especially for women, we actually find that there is a big gap where we can help them to ensure that they invest in a solution that can enable them to grow in the future.
Cool. Sure, thank you. And Nana, maybe a little bit about Microsoft.
Yes, so I would say our approach to this is threefold. There's a huge lack of competencies within the tech industry, not only for the tech giants as we are, but across all industries. When we look at our customers and our partners, they are screaming for the right competencies and more digital talent to be in the market. So I would say our approach is threefold. One is to work quite closely with the educational system to ensure that we inspire and stimulate younger girls to want to go into STEM, so science, tech, math, and engineering. So that's kind of the first, and we have a lot of programs around that of inspiring girls and giving them an opportunity to try and work with technology and what it can solve. Then we have programs around women and technology, so more broadly, to try and make a network around the women that are in technology and how do they progress and don't feel so alone. We work both with the role models, which I think is a quite important thing to say, put a different face on how does it look to be a geek. I'm a geek at heart. I don't eat pizza all the time. I actually love pizza, but don't eat it all the time. I stopped wearing socks and my sandals a few years back. But I think putting a different face to how would it look to have a career where you're actually changing the world. And then I think thirdly, we have also what's called Microsoft Ventures, which is our corporate venture fund, where we also engage quite directly with female founders and right now are running a competition where we are only looking at female-founded startups that we want to invest in and help accelerate.
Okay, thank you. So it's a lot of information to grasp and many valuable initiatives, I think. Do you have any initial thoughts about all of this, Alina? Because you would be, I think, in the perfect audience for all of these initiatives. So I would like to hear your initial take on it.
Yeah, I think both of you touch upon some really important points that are relevant in different stages of an entrepreneur's life, but especially also a female entrepreneur's life. So there's the pre-founding, just triggering interest in technology and seeing that you can actually create amazing solutions with technology. But then once you have founded a company and are in the business, supplying network, capital, that's been very, very helpful and valuable for us. And I think that's the way to go, just kind of building this like sisterhood almost, that you support each other and build up these role models, as you mentioned, so you can... You have people you can look up to and you can kind of follow their path. I think that's really important.
So, Charlotte, let me ask you, why is it important to have initiatives that are just for women rather than... Because all of this sounds really cool. It could be nice for the guys too, I think. So what is the discussion you've had in Dell around this?
Well, I mean, we have always supported innovation, looked at what good ideas are out there. We want to support these ideas to grow. But then diversity has always, just as like they have at Microsoft, diversity is super important to us. And I mean, we are a hardware company. You can just imagine how many women we have, like much more now than when I started 17 years ago. So diversity is super important. We need different people to represent the community that we are selling to. And there we go with the natural angle to the entrepreneurial story. You know, we took a look at why is 91% globally of the startup capital going to male-founded companies? 91%. Women have great ideas as well. Maybe it's not about tech, because we support all kinds of ideas, but we need to help them. And one of the major problems for female entrepreneurs is actually to get access to this capital. So we want to support that diversity, and therefore we are also, apart from this Dell Women Entrepreneurial Network, we are also following up with 12 events globally that we call Women Funding Women, where we are connecting new startup ideas with women that has a large company, and they can pitch their ideas and get connected, get best practices, and maybe get invested in.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So you called it sisterhood before. I think it's a good term for it. And Nana, are we in the process of building a new version of the old boys network here? What's going on from your point of view?
No, I think we definitely aren't. I think we need to do something special. If we start at the young age, research proves that if you want to inspire a girl to venture into engineering and science, you actually have to spark her interest before the age of 12. So if you don't catch them at an early age, they will become kind of a result of the biases around them and what they see and what they get told. So I think we have to do something particularly to get girls interested in going into the science field and trying to support solving some of the biggest problems in the world, which will be solved by technology, I'm pretty sure. So I think we have to do something specifically in the younger age to actually get them interested in going this way.
Okay.
And then I think kind of for the more mature women, the Women in Technology initiative that we're running is more to acknowledge that you might feel alone. You might feel that you don't fit in. You might sit at a conference where you're the only women. So ensuring then when we have our big global conferences, there's always kind of a sidetrack for women to network. And it's not because we want that them and us, but it's more to say, come here, exchange your ideas, and help us get more women in here.
Yes, absolutely. So we have actually some questions coming in on Slido now. I don't know if you can see them on these screens up here. Are they on the screen? Okay. So I think we'll ask Alina, what do you see as the greatest barriers for females to join the tech industry today? So you've joined it relatively recently, I wonder if you could share a bit of the experience that you've had from a practical perspective and how you overcame it, most importantly, because this is probably what parts of the audience is interested in.
Yeah. So I think it really starts with what Nana mentions, that from early on, girls are kind of shown, okay, you know, all you need to focus on when you read magazines is look pretty and how do you, get skinny and everything. The guys have the magazines where it's about how to build, how to explore and be wild. And to kind of get rid of that mindset and think, okay, I have an idea and I somehow know, this is where I want to go, so just go for it. And I would say the most important starting point where Suvi and I just said, okay, we need to go for this, is that first of all, horses were our lifelong passion, so it's a problem that we experienced ourselves for over 20 years. So it was very apparent to us, and just combining it with our innovation background, we thought, okay, there must be a better solution, we must change this. But it's also very dependent on what family background you come from, what university you go to. So I think it's really different circumstances. And on how to overcome it, I think it's just maybe also a matter of luck, finding the right co-founder. I mean, we got really lucky. And then just some kind of spark that makes you think, okay, I need to do this. I just simply cannot not do this.
All right, very cool. So one of the questions that I liked in the audience is this one. I saw that lots of men got up. It's too far from my eyesight. Lots of men got up and left at the start of this panel, which I saw that too. But we have a lot of other interesting sessions, so I'm sure it's not because of the topic. It's probably because they had other content that they wanted to share. But anyway, okay, so now the background is yellow. Now I can't see the question at all. Can you take the yellow
part? I can read it aloud. So it says, I saw a lot of men got up and left at the start.
Okay. Yeah.
Have you ever experienced that men didn't want to listen, work with you? How did you deal with that?
Yeah, so maybe we could take that from the, no offense, more senior people in the panel,
the old
and get
ladies.
Your experience from years in the industry on this topic. Did you ever have this experience, or is it just a myth? Are we just being overly sensitive?
So I can start. I noticed men getting up. I actually think the scope of the session was very oriented around females, right? So we could probably have had a broader title that would encourage men to stay here and listen to why is diversity important, or kind of a broader topic. So that I think we can put that on ourselves. I have to say I have not experienced men not wanting to work with me or not listening. I used to have a very technical job, so I started as a senior technical specialist where I only worked with men, and even in that time I was very very weird. I was 23, 24. And got out to IT departments and developers and architects in order to help them to kind of architect and build the next generation of their infrastructure. And I think in the beginning, what I felt at least was that people would look at you differently when you got into the room. But for me, it was more kind of a motivation to prove them wrong and to actually surprise them. So I think for me, it was the other way around, that I knew that I, when I came in, that would think like, oh, she's here to get us coffee. And they never said so. But they obviously thought I was the assistant to our account executive. And then when I was actually the one there with the brain, he had a brain too, probably. But I was the one that actually was competent on the field that we were there to discuss and the re-engineering of their IT infrastructure. Then quite fast, you would actually turn that around entirely. And for me, it actually became more of a benefit to be female, because that element of surprise made people listen more, and you actually get remembered because you're the one with the long hair who actually knew something. Mm. And that was nice.
Sure. Do you have anything to add to this?
Well, I mean, I must say I didn't expect myself to surprise the guys. I surprised myself. I was like, oh my God, I know what a frontside bus is. You know, I got the weirdest questions, but I knew that I had a whole army full of experts behind me that the guy on the other side didn't have. This was on the phone selling PCs in 2001. Once I sold a PC to a lady that thought it needed gasoline. So, yeah. But I kept on surprising myself. I was like, you know, I can do this too. And then I also realized that in the tech industry, I have a background of doing a lot of theater, music, and things like that. You know, I don't have a tech background. I wasn't even interested in. Now I am. But we need everybody. And I'm really trying to make this clear to my daughter that even at Dell, we need somebody that loves to put on a great show and articulate the message clearly. So we really, really need everybody. And I still like demystifying like hyperconvergence and things like this. You know, it's like really, whoa, I know what this is. You know, it's really nice. And it's always something new, and it's so hot. And like I said before, you know, although we support any kind of startups, they all need tech. So it's so relevant and fun to work with.
Mm. Mm. Okay. So I think personally, I had a quite extensive corporate-type career before I started Qt, and I think I can relate to a lot of the things that you both said. Before I worked in technology, I had a chance to work for 6 or 7 years in ocean shipping, so that's a lot of men and different tone and stuff. So I can relate to some of this, and I agree with what you said, Nana, that you have to turn it into an advantage. You have to say, okay, I'm going to stand out no matter what in this room, and I deserve my seat here. I should sit at the table. I should take my position. And then the obvious benefit is that everyone will remember what you said. Just try not to say anything too stupid or ignorant or whatever, and then you'll be fine. But it's important to say something meaningful in the context, and then you can have the benefit of being remembered more. Another benefit that I've experienced over the time as a person building a startup is that as a female entrepreneur, you do have an advantage of getting invited to more events just because you're female, and you can say, oh, it's all wrong, I don't like quotas, all this stuff. But it is what it is, and it's important to show yourself as a role model and participate in these kinds of things. You're also more likely to get stage time on different events and speak. So I would encourage people to do that because it can help your business a lot by spreading the knowledge and you standing out as a knowledgeable entrepreneur. So you have to find the guts to do this and then turn it into an advantage. And if you're invited, for example, if you're fundraising for your company and you're invited to an investor dinner and you kind of have a feeling that it's probably just because they want women, because I know all these other companies that are also great and they're not invited, but they're men founders, then take the ticket. They're not going to invest in you because you're a woman. You might get into the dinner because you're a woman, but who cares? It doesn't matter. If you can get the access to whatever is the stuff is happening that you need, then take the ticket and then prove yourself worth it. Nobody's going to put money in your startup if you're not worth it. So So that's just a word of encouragement from my side. I know I'm not a panelist, but I can still say my opinion. So anyway, we have more questions. This is great. You're so active on Slido. I love that. So one we have here is, where can we network with women in tech? Are there any relevant associations or organizations in Copenhagen? And I would like to start with you, Alina, on this one. What is your go-to network in the local scene here?
I mean, there's the Women in Tech Network, which is actually quite big by now. And they do events and talks and, also get these local ladies on stage to give them a voice. And, they do a very, like, also summits and technical events. And I think everything is on the website. There's a lot coming up beginning of next year, especially.
All right. Yeah. Very cool. Do you have any I know you have an event coming up in Dell in November for Women in Tech. And you have a few other initiatives. Maybe you want to share a little bit
exactly.
about those local in Copenhagen.
Yep. Exactly. So one of my big babies at work is that I'm in charge of 55 Dell Technologies forums in Europe and Middle East. And we are coming to Copenhagen to Lokomotiv Verkstaden. Over there somewhere, the 1st of November. And here we have a Women in Technology event, a lunch, where we are gonna put on a panel. We are gonna have different representatives from the Danish IT community, female representatives, but also a couple of men, because at Dell, it's very important. Like, without the guys wanting diversity, it's not gonna work. Then it's gonna become a coffee club, you know? So we have a lot of leaders at Dell that we have a program called Men Advocating Real Change. So we are really talking about our biases, so our prejudiced thoughts about different, you know, different kind of personalities, different cultures, and we are really bringing this up in a very systematic program. And these sessions are very often led by our leaders, which many of them are men. So we're going to have this Women in Technology lunch at our event the 1st of November. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes,
just kind of a short comment for me would actually be an advice to you to be much more proactive and reach out directly to people that you meet and that inspire it and that you think can support your startup or your career. I've done different kind of appearances in the startup community, both as a mentor or a speaker, but also sit in boards. And I can see men are much better at reaching out. So they will just write me on LinkedIn saying, I'll buy you a cup of coffee if you'll review my the architectural setup for my new app, or I'll buy you if you'll help me develop my go-to-market strategy. So I think that proactive reaching out and actually asking for help and knowing that you actually have something cool that people would be willing to invest time in, I've not seen a lot of females do that. I think there's only one female that I have a connection to, and that's because kind of an investor introduced us. But I think you should be much more proactive and much more proud of what you're doing, and ask for support, because I actually see female entrepreneurs get too far on their own before they ask for help. And sometimes that actually doesn't give you the best chances of building a unicorn, right? So if you open up earlier and get input, get brain power, get network, get the support and funding to actually accelerate your idea, you're much better off. But we want to do it on our own, and we want to make sure it's really good before we present it to anyone. So be more brave and much earlier reach out to cool people you meet and just ask for help.
You'll get 50 messages in your inbox immediately after this event.
Yeah. I'll try and answer. But I really do think there's a big difference on the way female and male founders approach getting support and funding.
Yeah, and I think this is also important to encourage the more senior female entrepreneurs and technologists that we have in the room, that you also need to be conscious of your role to pay it forward and help the young or people starting up, I guess. It could not necessarily have to do with age, but to also take a little bit of time here and there and help people out that are about to start a company or early stage or whatever, and just be responsive and not always prioritize your own thing. It's what we all need. So, and I think we all try to do this in this group for sure.
I actually have a good tip for that, because I think what helped us a lot was sitting in a co-working space where you naturally get to talk with different people, get introduced to advisors, investors, And so it's a bit more natural. Maybe that's especially good for women who are not so good in asking for help. So it's not such a big step. You know, there's a lot of people coming in on a weekly basis you can just talk to. So if you have an idea and you have the opportunity, also sit in one of the free incubators of the university, or there's a lot of them, like definitely grab that chance. It helped us a lot.
We have a few of them represented out here in the stands today, so you can take a walk around and talk to them. I think this is a really good piece of advice, Alina, so thank you for that.
Also some of the investors, so go visit them.
Yes.
They have more money than they have good ideas.
Exactly. All right, with that. So I think we should end with a practical guide to how to access the programs that you've presented today, and what's the easiest way to get started on some of the programs that you have for female entrepreneurs and technologists. Do you want to start, Charlotte?
Yes, sure. So we have our Copenhagen event, 1st of November. Both men and women are welcome to talk about, you know, inclusion, diversity in the IT industry, 1st of November. And to join the Dell Women Entrepreneurial Network, anybody can join this if you're a female entrepreneur. Unfortunately, we do not have a Dell for Entrepreneurs Network in Denmark yet, but I am very inspired by being here for the first time, so, you know, maybe we'll set that up as well. So I will hang around in the coffee area. My name is Charlotte, I'm from Dell, and you're more than welcome to come up with me, and we can talk about the network, we can talk about the specific event we have on November the 1st, and yeah, I hope to see you out there.
And one practical detail on that, right after this panel, we are fortunate to have an interview with Microsoft and Dell going on in the back, so if you don't see Charlotte out there immediately after, it's going to be about 10, 15 minutes, and then she'll come out, so don't worry about that. Nana, do you have final words?
Yeah, just one specific thing, because you told me to focus, which is difficult. So right now, Microsoft Ventures, who are now called M12, are running a competition together with the EQT Ventures and Silicon Valley Bank, where they're looking for female founders. So actually a chance, they have two grants of $2 million each. The nomination stops at September 30th, so you have the week out to actually go and put yourself into that pool. It's quite a lot of funding, actually, depending on the stage you're in. The rules are pretty simple. There needs to be at least one female founder. You cannot have had more than 4 million of funding already. And if you go to m12.vc, you should get all the details. So at least I would encourage, there's both a competition in the US, in Europe, and in Israel specifically. So there's kind of three legs of the competition. But definitely a good chance not only to get funding, but actually to get technical support, technical capacity, and also get support to accelerate your business model from Microsoft Ventures and the partners.
Great. So that's it for the questions that we had prepared for you guys today. I really appreciate you coming, and I hope we can all continue the talk about these things. We did have some questions that we did not have time to address, so I'm sorry about that. But you're free to contact any of us. We will be around for a little while after the panel. So do that and reach out to each other, talk amongst yourselves. It's the most important thing we can do is find each other. So I would encourage you to do that. So thank you for joining this morning, and I hope you enjoy the rest of TechBBQ very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.